Hi, my name is Jimmy Painter. I'm the senior pastor here at Crest Hill. I came today to tell you that God has a word for you. In 1991, a judge fined brothers Gino and Russell Capozzillo, owners of a Bridgeport, Connecticut wrecking company, nearly $900,000, and they were fined for operating, watch this now, an illegal dump. In 1986, on the empty lot surrounding their facility, the brothers began dumping debris from buildings. Eventually, the mound of rubble covered 2 acres and reached a height of 35 feet, the equivalent of a three-story building. The state ordered them to clean it up, but the brothers claimed that there was no place for them to dump the debris legally in Bridgeport, and they couldn't afford to have it hauled away. And while spending more than $330,000 the previous year to have the debris hauled away, they barely, watch this, dented the pile. According to Gino, and I quote, "It was never supposed to get this high. Like garbage, the effects of sinful habits have a way of accumulating beyond our plans and beyond our control." Hear me, please. Sin plays no favorites. Sin always tempts and always tempts us to choose our own way. Sin, by definition, is rebellion, and rebellion is both harmful and addictive. Repetition of sinful behavior leads us to more sinful behavior until that sinful behavior is so entrenched that we cannot stop it. That, by technical definition, is called, watch this now, slavery. Where once you thought you owned it, it now owns you. Thanks be to God, He's made a way to deliver us from the shackles and the bondage and the enslavement of sin. Titus chapter 2, verses 11 through 14 tells us this: "For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation for all people, training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in the present age, waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for himself a people for his own possession who are zealous for good works." How many of us are tormented by a stronghold of sin? How many of us are exhausted from the never-ending cycle of being tempted, fighting not to commit that sin, failing and falling, sorrowful and broken by guilt and shame, coming to God once again, asking for forgiveness, vowing never again to commit that sin? And then the entire sickening process begins all over again. How many of us have been there? How many of us are there? I want you to know that I, too, am a fellow struggler who has battled habitual sin just like you. And I came out on the other side victorious. Also, I came today to share with you that in order to overcome habitual sin, we've got to know a few things. Here's the first thing that we need to know. We need to know that the descent into the pattern of sin begins in our minds. The descent into the pattern of sin begins in our minds. Allow me to date myself just a little bit here. Some of you out there remember the classic fright scene in Alfred Hitchcock's movie Psycho. No doubt, if you watch that, and right about now as you're thinking about that, you can still relive how you reacted when Janet Leigh was stabbed to death. Where? In the shower. Does even the thought of that, picturing it in your mind, cause you to tense up? Did you know that thousands of people reported being unable to take a shower after they watched that movie unless somebody else was in the house? When some people went to movie theaters to watch this for the first time, it is reported that they jumped, they screamed, they cried. Some even ran out of the theater. Why? Because that scene was portrayed so vividly that their minds reacted to it, watch this, as if it were real. Stabbing was dramatized so realistically that it had a dramatic effect on viewers, watch this now, for years to come. If a movie producer can cause such an intense reaction in our minds, think about the power we have over our own minds. Thoughts and mental images control the body. Russians have a proverb that says, the brain is capable of holding a conversation with the body that ends in death. Many of us make fun of people who talk to themselves. But truth be told, most of us have similar conversations, just not out loud. These conversations are between, in our minds, what we ought to do and what we want to do. Habitual sin is when we allow our minds to stack the deck in favor of our wanting to do this or that. The Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, the fifth verse, to take every thought captive. That means that we have a chance to do something about all of the thoughts that are not pleasing to God before they enter our hearts and become a part of us. Stephen Lank, in his blog on active Christianity, it's called activechristianity.org, he writes, as a man thinks, so he is. What we think about is crucial to who we are. Scientists don't agree on how many thoughts we have each day, but all of them agree that there are thousands of them. Who we are, shaped moment by moment by the thoughts we choose to let into our minds and our hearts, but how we control the thousands of thoughts that enter our minds each day. How do we do that? What we do with the thoughts that are not pleasing to God. How can we, in reality, take every thought captive? For most of us, our thoughts have to be focused on the tasks that we have to accomplish on any given day. However, as we go through the day, we can catch thoughts that are contrary to God's will, and we can keep them from gaining control of our mind and our hearts and our attitudes. Paul explains how this is possible. In 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 4 through 5, he writes, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. That means they're not fleshly. They're not natural. They're supernatural. But mighty in God, he writes, for pulling down strongholds. That means sin that is set up in our lives that is so deeply rooted that we ourselves cannot pull it out. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity, watch this, to the obedience of Christ. Unless we have our thoughts bow down and obey Jesus, there's no point in taking them captive. The point of taking our thoughts captive is to have them follow Jesus. It is written that we need to battle to keep our thoughts pure, but it is also written that we have weapons to fight with. So don't forget that today. There are weapons in your arsenal of warfare that God has given you to do what He's calling you to do. So let's for just a moment consider a typical day and a typical daily situation where you have the opportunity to take your thoughts captive. So let's think about this for a moment. Perhaps your supervisor at work gives you a task that you hate. Hey, does that sound familiar? Your supervisor gives you a task that you hate, and negative, complaining thoughts come into your head. These thoughts are temptations, and you have a chance to do something about them before they enter into your heart and they become a part of your day. It is these types of thoughts that we need to take captive by instead choosing to obey the Word of God rather than those negative thoughts. To obey God's Word rather than those negative words. We need to obey words of God such as those recorded in Philippians 2:14 that says, do all things, watch this now, without grumbling and complaining. Such a choice requires a real battle in our thought life. As our thoughts go, so do we. The battle, make no mistake about it, is for your mind. If somebody like me has ever said to you that God has a destiny for you, God has an exciting life for you, and God wants you to live an abundant life, and you've not experienced it, I would say unto you that you are losing the battle right here in your mind. Such a choice requires a real battle in our thought life, but the weapons of our warfare, the Word of God and the power of the Holy Spirit, are mighty to help us. By praying to God the moment when we sense we are being tempted, we can receive power to keep our thoughts pure. And then we can take every one of those thoughts captive. Hear me, please. We must also strengthen ourselves for this warfare beforehand by following Jesus' example when he was tempted by the devil to turn the stones into bread, if you remember that story. Jesus said, but it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. The Word of God and the power of the Holy Spirit are mighty to help you and me take our negative thoughts captive. If we notice there are areas of our thought life that we find difficult to overcome, we can find specific scriptures that can help us get victory over them. Your Bible is your toolbox. Your Bible is filled full of references. You're saying, well, I don't have one. Well, thanks be to God that you can go online to places like BibleGateway.com and look those texts up. God has given us specific words to address the specific situations in our lives. So use it. It'll help get you through. Let me give you an example. If we know that we are easily tempted to have impure thoughts about the opposite sex, we can take Jesus' words to heart. In Matthew chapter 5, verses 28 through 29, Jesus said, but I say to you, whoever looks at a woman to lust at her has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to sin, pluck it out. Now, don't go and do that literally. That's called a hyperbole, an exaggerated statement to make a point. But here's the point that he's making. If your right eye causes you to sin, pluck it out and cast it from you, for it is more profitable for you that one of your members perish than your whole body be cast into hell. Folks, our eyes get us into trouble. But it's not just our eyes, it's the thoughts behind them that motivate all of that. If we are prone to anger, we can arm ourselves with James' exhortation in James chapter 1, verses 19 through 20. Here's what he writes. So then, my beloved, that means you and me. So then, let every man or woman be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. That means getting real worked up and ticked off at somebody. Come on, let's be honest. Like, that's never happened to you? Keep it real. It happens to us all. Slow to wrath. For the wrath of man or a woman does not produce the righteousness of God. When you get really angry at somebody so that it processes in your thoughts, and what you begin thinking about are all of the ways you want to take this sucker out, that doesn't please God. The word righteousness in the Greek is the word dikaiosune. It means to be, watch this, in a right relationship with God, but also in a right relationship with other people. If you're so angry that you want to remove people from this planet, how are you going to have a right relationship with them? How are you going to pray for them? How are you going to, watch this now, lead them to Christ, or if they are a Christian, how are you going to encourage them and pour into their life so that they will become more like Jesus? You can't do that if you're so steaming mad that all you can think about is taking them out. By the Holy Spirit, we can get grace and power to bring every one of our thoughts into captivity and to bring them into captivity to the obedience of Christ. And in the process, we become transformed into the person that He wants us to be. We have the wonderful hope that by overcoming these sins in our thought life, we can become more like Jesus as each day progresses. In this way, we become valuable tools in God's hands. If we are going to overcome the habitual sin that has taken us captive, we need to know that the descent into the pattern of sin begins where? It begins in our minds. Next week, we will discover that we are going to overcome habitual sin that has taken us captive. If we're going to do that, that we need to know a couple more things. We're going to learn next week, number two, that sin and its demands keep increasing, yet sin's benefits are only short term. We're also going to learn that faith in Jesus sets us free from sin's domination. So I say unto you today, until then, press on. Victory over the sin in your life is yours in Christ. Today, as we prepare to close, I want to invite you to have a personal relationship with Jesus. I want to invite you today to accept not religion, but a relationship. Today, I want to invite you to reach out, if you've never done this before, and ask God to come into your heart and take total control of not just your thoughts, but your whole life. Hear me, please. The things that I've shared today, they are impossible to do unless Jesus is living inside of you. And so today, I want to invite you to ask Christ to come into your heart. It's not a complex thing to do. It's simple, but it's not easy. It takes great courage. Once again, I'm not talking about religion. I'm not talking about joining a church, even though that's an important thing to do. I'm not talking about being baptized or catechized or any type of a religious practice or anything like that. I'm talking about something that is passionate and personal that is between you and God. So if that's never happened in your life, I want to invite you right now, if you'll allow me to help you, to ask Jesus to come into your heart. Would you pray this prayer with me right now? Would you, and make it real, make it your own, and say, Jesus, you repeat that right now. Jesus, come into my heart. I turn away from my sin. I turn away from myself. I turn to you. I receive you as my Savior. I make you the Lord of my life. If you prayed that prayer right now and you truly meant it, I came today to tell you that at 11:17 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, that you were born again, that this great big old God came to set up residence right in here, and you'll never be alone. He'll never forsake you. He'll be with you all of your days. If you prayed that prayer, would you let me know right now? I'd love to be able to help you in this new walk with Jesus. I want to put some materials in your hand. I want to send those to you. Would you contact me today? I have a very simple email. It's painter@cresthill.org. That's all you need. painter@cresthill.org. Contact me today and let me know of your decision. If you're a genuine believer in Jesus and you've had a continual battle over your thought life, but today you've made a decision to put into practice not only the things that we've learned here, but we're going to discover next week, but you're saying today, I have victory in Jesus. I am a victor. I'm not a victim. I'm the head. I'm not the tail. I'm tired of living this way, living according to circumstances and living a defeated life, and I'm going to win a victorious life. Well, it begins with a commitment. God can help you. He's ready and waiting. Would you pray this prayer with me right there where you are and say, Heavenly Father, I know I've struggled in my thought life. I know that I've been defeated by my thoughts. I'm not going to live that way anymore. In Jesus' name, I commit myself to using your word, opening myself up to the infilling and the anointing of the Holy Spirit. And I'm going to have a victorious life over my thoughts in Jesus' name. If you prayed that prayer and you meant it and you were sincere about it, I came today to tell you it's yours. I've said this before, but let me say it again. When it comes to fights with the devil, the fight is fixed. You cannot lose. Victory is already yours. Doesn't mean that you don't have to come out swinging, but it's already yours. You've made that commitment today. God's going to help you topple that giant in your thought life. Would you let me know about your decision today? Once again, my email address is very, very simple. It's painter@cresthill.org. That's all that you need. Contact me today. We want to help you as you grow in your victorious life. I want to share with you today that reaching the world for Jesus through an online telecast like this, well, it's not cheap. We need your help. In order to continue doing what we're doing here today, reaching people locally in our community, reaching people across our nation, and reaching people across the globe, I'm delighted to share with you that I've received reports that we have people all over the United States that are a part of our worship together on these Sundays. We have people all over the globe, people in Central and South America, people in other places around the nations that are here with us today. If this has blessed you in any way, even if you don't live in our locale, but you consider Cresthill your church home, would you partner with us in ministry so that not only we can continue to do the things that we're doing, but so that we can expand and reach even more people for Jesus? Would you bless us today with your prayers? Would you also bless us today with a financial gift? You can go online right now to you can give at cresthill.org/give. That's all you need. cresthill.org/give. cresthill.org/give. And at that place, you can give whatever God lays on your heart. I know these are difficult times, particularly financially. But can I tell you, I truly believe that God will bless you richly as you partner with us in ministry. It's been a joy to worship with you today. It's been a joy to allow us to come into your home or your location, wherever you may be. And so I say unto you, until next week, God loves you. We love you. Keep the faith.